بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، أما بعد. Continuing on our study of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah's treatise of Aqidat al-Wasatiyya, we reached the portion of the treatise where Shaykh al-Islam says Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah are moderate amongst all the sects of the Ummah. So of the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from those groups that have broken away from the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam but are still in the fold of Islam, Ahl Sunnah is moderate and in between those various sects and groups, because all of them have transgressed the bounds. Anytime you try to go beyond the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in your understanding, in your worship, in your fiqh, your jurisprudence, whatever it may be, then you have transgressed the boundaries, tajawaz al-had, that you have possibly fallen into a type of innovation. And innovation, as we've mentioned in many of our lectures, innovation is of two types. We have bid'ah mukaffara wa bid'ah ghayr mukaffara. Bid'ah mukaffara meaning bid'ah that takes you out of the fold of Islam. Bid'ah ghayr mukaffara means religious innovation which is not to the point of heresy. Heresy meaning taking you out of the fold of Islam. So there's various types of bid'ah a person can fall into in their ibadah, meaning doing things that are not mentioned in the Quran, not mentioned in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not mentioned by the Salaf of this Ummah, and are newly invented practices. As the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, kullu bid'atin dalala, and every innovation or every bid'ah is misguidance. Wa kullu bid'atin dalala wa kullu dalalatin fin nar, and every misguidance leads to the hellfire. So going astray and going beyond the religious boundaries, whether it be through secularism, whether it be through issues in Aqidah and Creed, whether it be like the Khawarij and those extremists like Al-Qaeda and those other groups who make takfir and consider other Muslims to be non-Muslims without the right to do so, whether they call people to rebelling against the Muslim authorities, whether they call people to protest and democracy and all these various things that are not mentioned in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they're all various types of innovation. Some of them leading a person out of the fold of Islam, and some of them a person remains in the fold of Islam but they are a sinner and they are doing religious innovation. So all of it is madhmum, all of it is sinful. And Ahl Sunnah, they are in the middle course. So they are not weak with the nusus, with the religious text, and they do not go to the other extreme. And they're in the middle with regards to the other sects, and we're going to talk about it in detail when we mention some of the other sects and what they believe around the creed. And as we mentioned countless times, this treatise with regards to Tawheed, Aqidat al-Wasatiyyah, is mainly in reference to the general creed of Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah, highlighting the general creed, and especially with regards to Tawheed, the issue of Al-Asma'i wa Sifat. Al-Asma'i wa Sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the divine names and attributes of Allah Rabbil Alameen, the one who created the heavens and earth, the only one worthy of worship, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Shaykh al-Islam said, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said after mentioning some of the names and attributes of Allah approved or affirmed in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِلَّا أَمْثِلْ إن أمثل هذه الأحاديث التي يخبر فيها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن ربه بما يخبر به فإن الفرقة الناجية أهل السنة والجماعة يؤمنون بذلك كما يؤمنون بما أخبر الله به في كتابه من غير تحريف ولا تعتيل ومن غير تكيف ولا تمثيل بل هم الوسط في فرق الأمة كما أن الأمة هي الوسط في الأمم فهم وسط في باب الصفات صفات الله سبحانه وتعالى بين الأهل التعتيل الجهمية وأهل التمثيل المشابهة وهم وسط في باب الأفعال الله بين الجبرية والقدرية وغيرهم وفي باب وعيد الله بين المرجية وبين الوعيدية من القدرية وغيرهم وفي باب الأسماء الإيمان والدين بين الحرورية والمعتزلة وبين المرجية والجهمية وفي أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بين الرافضة وبين الخوارج. So here Sheikh Islam rahimahullah ta'ala gave us or illustrated for us and highlighted for us that Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah are moderate amongst all the sects of the Ummah, similar to the way the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is moderate between the other, between the Jews and the Christians and the other nations with regards to their belief systems and so forth. In such hadith in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has told us about Allah the Almighty and the Glorious, the men, the Ahlul Sunnah, the saved sect, Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah, have faith in the same manner as they have faith in what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has informed them of in His book, meaning the Quran, without distorting and negating and without adding qualities and making a resemblance between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His creation. In fact, among all the sects of the Ummah, this sect alone, meaning the Firqat al-Najiyah or Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah or Ahl Hadith or Ahl Athar or the Salafiyun or the Salaf al-Salih, whatever you want to describe them as, which are names coming from Kitabillah wa Sunnatul Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Salaf of this Ummah radiyallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in, that in fact among all the sects of the Ummah, this sect alone, Ahl Sunnah, is moderate, just as the community of Muslims is moderate, is a moderate one among all the other communities, amongst the Hindus, the Sikhs, the Buddhists, the Christians, the Jews, etc. The followers of Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah occupy a moderate position between Ahl Ta'til, meaning the Jahamiyyah, meaning those who negate the divine names of attributes and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Ahl Tamthil, meaning the Mushabiha, the Mutashabiha, or the Mushabiha, meaning those people who make a resemblance between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His creation, and are moderate between the Jabariyya sect and the Qadariyya. And we're going to talk about who the Jabariyya, meaning those people who believe in Jabr, meaning that we are forced, the Qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we're forced to do what we do so that we are not responsible for our action. We are forced to do everything we do. This is what they believe. This is another type of extremism which is not from Islam. And the Qadariyya, those people who believe the various types of innovation with regards to the Qadr. Some of them the Jabariyya, meaning that we are forced to do, and some who believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is unaware of our actions and that we have total complete free will and etc. And there are various forms of deviation with regards to the Qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that these sects have. The Qadariyya sect regarding the acts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and are moderate about the promises of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning the wa'id of Jannah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised the believers with paradise, and between the Murjiya and the Wa'idiyya, those people who like the Khawarij and some of the Qadariyya who are extreme with regards to the punishments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Mu'tazila, believing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that people who do sins, that there's nothing in between for them, that a sinner is a disbeliever to the Khawarij and the Mu'tazila. And the Mu'tazila believe that they are baina manzilatain, that they are in a place between paradise and Jannah. This is also a deviant creed which has no precedence in the Quran, in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, nor from the Salaf of this Ummah radiyallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in. And the Khawarij, as we mentioned before, Ahl Takfir, those people who make takfir of the Muslims if they fall into sin. So if a person drinks alcohol, a person commits zina, a person looks at pornography, a person does whatever sin, these people believe that they are disbelievers, that they no longer have the rights of a Muslim. And this is incredibly deviant creed and an incredibly wicked sin and innovation in the religion, because they are deviating from the creed of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the creed of Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah, which lets us know that a Muslim can be a sinner. And a Muslim can be strong in iman. Our iman fluctuate. And just because a person commits sins does not mean there are that they have left the fold of Islam. As the Prophet ﷺ said, "Kullu ibn Adam khata wa khayran khata'ina tawabun," that all the children of Adam, they make mistakes, and the best of those who sin is those who make tawbah. And I want to read, before we get into talking about these sects, and maybe we'll reserve that for the next lesson, let's listen to some of the athar of the Salaf, some of the statements of the Salaf of this Ummah about Ahl Sunnah, how they deal with the Nusus, because all of these other sects we mention, the Jahamiyyah, the Mu'tazila, the Qadariya, the Karamata, the Asha'ira, the Maturidiyya, the Rafida and the Khawarij, all of these other sects, they have some type of deviance in creed. Some of them outside of the fold of Islam, as the Salaf of this Ummah used to make takfir of the Jahamiyyah. So they say a person who has the creed of the Jahamiyyah, then they're a disbeliever, especially with regards to the Quran being created and things like this. They hold this creed that the Quran is created. But this is not the creed of Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah. And the Salaf of this Ummah, Imam Ahmed and those who preceded him, they made takfir of the Jahamiyyah for this. And as we mentioned, this is a bid'ah mukaffara. And the bid'ah ghayr mukaffara, for example, the Asha'ira, they make tahrif with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's asma'i wa sifat. With some of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's sifat, they explain it according to their intellect. And they distort the meaning, the true meaning. They go away from what the Quran shows as evidence, what the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ shows as evidence, what the Salaf of this Ummah shows as evidence, and sometimes even what the language, the Arabic language, shows as evidence. But they come to their own conclusion in accordance with their intellect. Ahl Sunnah does not make takfir of the Asha'ira, but rather they say they are deviant in their creed. They're closest to Ahl Sunnah because they, in many other aspects of the creed of Ahl Sunnah, they might have agreeance with Ahl Sunnah. But however, they deviate with regards to many of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's divine attributes. And instead, for example, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in an authentic hadith, "Yanzilu Rabbuna ila sama' dunya," that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends to the heavens in the last third of the night. Ahl Sunnah says we believe that. We believe it. We don't know how, we don't try to describe it, but we believe it because it is affirmed in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam doesn't lie. We leave it at that. They will look at that same nas and they'll say, okay, yes, it's a sahih hadith, but it doesn't fit our intellect. So what we say is it means this, it means Allah's mercy descends, or it means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they give it another meaning which fits their intellect, but does not go with the tafsir of the Sahaba, radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in. And this is where Ahl Sunnah, and they disagree. So we would say about them is that they have bid'ah ghayr mukaffara, or this is because the ulama say that they have ta'wil. They have the excuse of ta'wil. And this is one of the things which prohibit a person from making takfir. Some of the mu'ana of takfir, meaning that what prevents making takfir on a particular individual is that they might have udhr bijahil. They may have the excuse of being ignorant. For example, a new Muslim, he doesn't know that he has to pray five times a day maybe, or he doesn't know whatever. So he refuses in that particular situation because of his ignorance. So then you make it clear for him, so that way he can clear those shubahat, clear and move away from that. Or someone, they've never had teachers in their locality. Some places in India, they've been far away from ulama their whole existence as Muslims, and they hold a creed almost similar to the Hindus, some of their actions. So maybe they will be excused for ignorance, and this is for the ulama to decide. So that's called udhr bijahil. Another situation, and this is where the Asha'ira fall, is udhr bita'wil. That because of their ta'wil, because of their, they're not denying the nusus directly, but rather more indirectly, because they're changing the meaning. And with this, the ulama of Islam have written extensively with regards to all the madhahib of fiqh about this issue, the udhr bita'wil, that the mu'awwil is excused from making tekfir of him, because he has distorted the meaning, but he has not maybe directly negated it. So this is one of the excuses. So in this case, you should teach them if they are open to listening to the haq. Listen to how some of the effort of the Salaf, of how Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah are amongst, how they are moderate with amongst the other sects, because they accept the Nusus of the Kitabillah wa Sunnah Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam Al-Zai, rahimahullah ta'ala, stated, Al-Zuhri and Maqhul say, meaning some of the Tabi'een, accept the Hadith as they came. This is the minhaj of Ahlul Sunnah, that we take those Nusus about whatever it is, and especially about Asma'i wa Sifat, or specifically about Asma'i wa Sifat as well, that Ahlul Sunnah accept it as it comes. This is the minhaj of the Salaf. This is why we say we're Salafi. We try to follow the madhab of the Salaf of this Ummah, radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in, meaning the Sahaba and the Tabi'een wa Taba'at Tabi'een. So here's what the Tabi'een, they said. They say, accept the Hadith as they came. Narrated Walid ibn Muslim, who said, I asked Auza'i and Sufyan al-Thawri and Malik ibn Anas and Al-Layth bin Sa'ad on those Hadith about seeing, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then they said, accept them without asking how. Look at this is the madhab of the Salaf. Accept the Nusus, don't ask the kayfiyah. We don't know how. So then we don't need to distort the meaning to fit our intellect, because we don't know how, we just accept it. Allah said this, we accept it. The Prophet ﷺ said this, we accept it. Imam Sufyan ibn Uyayna, rahimahullah ta'ala, was asked on some of the hadith about divine attributes. Then he said, they are as it was narrated, we accept them and narrate them without asking how. The madhab of the Salaf. Imam Ahmed bin Hanbal, rahimahullah ta'ala, said, whoever does not understanding the meaning of a hadith and has sound intellect should suffice with it. And more befitting for him, therefore, he should believe and be content with it. As-sam'u wa-ta'a. Accept and obey. Listen to the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. If it's proven, it's authentic, we accept it. Ayats from the Quran, we accept it about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's divine attributes, and we're content with it. That is the madhab of Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah. Imam Ali bin Al-Madini stated, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, belief in hadith and believing in them, do not ask how or why, rather believe in it. Rather, as long as he has sound intellect and believe in it and have faith in it, even if he does not know the explanation of the hadith, you believe it. That is sufficient. That is sufficient, and he was ordered to believe and accept it. That means this is the madhab of the Salaf. We're ordered to believe and accept the Nusus of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Imam Abu Ubaid al-Qasim bin Salam, rahimahullah ta'ala, said, these sound hadith that were narrated by the people of hadith and the scholars of jurisprudence, and to us, they are the truth, and we possess no doubt about them. However, if it is asked, how does he place his feet, meaning about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how does he laugh, how Allah laughs, we say he did not explain that, and we have not heard of anyone who explained it. Allahu Akbar. Had the madhab of Salaf. Why not accept the madhab of the Salaf? Those are the statements of the Salaf. That's what they said. We accept it. And here he mentioned exact Nusus. He mentioned some of the alfaz of the Nusus. He mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his feet, how he placed his feet. We don't ask how. We don't know. We don't ask about things we don't know about. We accept them. How does he laugh? We mentioned the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, where the Prophet ﷺ said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala laughs at the one who kills the Muslim and then is martyred himself. Meaning that he becomes a Muslim and then he's martyred. Fi sabilillah. Both of them were killed fi sabilillah. They both were martyred for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah laughs at them. We don't know how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala laughs. We accept that he laughs. We accept the Nusus, and we don't ask how. And that is what Imam Abu Ubaid al-Qasim al-Salam, rahimahullah ta'ala, said. Imperative that we accept the Nusus. Dr. Abdulaziz Humeidi states, these athar, meaning these narrations of the Salaf, illustrate for us that the Salaf were not responsible for knowledge that there was no way to attain. Meaning we don't have knowledge of the kayfiyah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's sifat. We can't go into depth into knowledge we don't have knowledge about. We accept it. We just accept the haq as it came. And we're not asked, we're not required of that. We're not required, those things will not bring us extra benefit in our ibadah, in doing our duties to Allah. We have what's sufficient. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what he came with, the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam are sufficient for us. And the madhab of the Salaf is sufficient for us. That's all we need to come closer to Allah, to get to Jannah. That's what we need. So we stop with that knowledge. We don't try to ask kayf and how this, and what about this, and this doesn't make sense to me. My limited intellect tells me this, his limited intellect tells him that, her limited intellect tells her this. We don't ask that. Ahl Sunnah accepts the Nusus. So he said, this is knowledge, the Salaf were not responsible for knowledge that there was no way to attain, like researching about how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's divine attributes are. Instead, they left the knowledge of describing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's divine attributes to Him the Almighty, while affirming and acknowledging the characteristics and their knowledge of their meanings. Allahu Akbar. This is what the madhab of the Salaf as-Sali. This is what we call to. This is the madhab of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And we ask Allah the Almighty to accept our good and forgive our evil. Anything I said that was correct was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anything I said that was incorrect was from myself and the shaitan. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika an ushrika bika wa ana a'lamu astaghfiruka lima la a'lamu.